Hello and happy Halloween, folks. I'm Tony Velasquez. Welcome to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Tales of ghosts, goblins, and gremlins can give you goosebumps, especially at this time of the year. But what's really scary year in and year out is the threat of sabotage and data theft to the online systems of both the government and private sector groups. It's been over a year since the Supreme Court upheld the constitutionality of the Philippine Cybercrime Prevention Act of 2012. And just last month, President Aquino issued an executive order forming the National Cybersecurity Interagency Committee. The committee is tasked to coordinate government agencies in preparing effective measures to strengthen their cybersecurity. The committee is chaired by the Executive Secretary and co-chaired by the head of the National Security Council and the DOST Secretary. Let's find out more about the challenges faced by the NCIAC from DOST's ICTO office, Celita Evans. Ma'am, thank you very much for coming over. Happy Halloween to you.
Happy Halloween to you also.
How many other departments or line agencies are part of the interagency committee?
There's about 11 of them. Mm-hmm. You have the Department of Energy, you have the Department of Finance, okay. You have the National Telecommunication Commission, and also you have the Department of Justice.
Yeah.
So around 11 of them are, you know, a part of the committee, mostly infrastructure. Definitely we need to have the infrastructure, you know, part of it as well.
Okay. I'm kind of curious about why the DOE is part of the interagency committee. I mean, why is that something that has to be included?
Because they're part of the critical infrastructure of the government. So you have the, you know,
they're also prone to hacking.
Yes, yeah. They are. Remember that the ICT runs on power. So it's very important that our power grids are actually protected from it also.
Mm-hmm.
So part of the work of the NCIAC is to look at the vulnerabilities around the country and assess, you know, the security posture when it comes to, you know, securing and defending the Philippine cyberspace.
Wow.
Hacking does not only happen in the virtual environment, because there's an example where I can't remember one of the countries where they were hacked because of the USB that was left at the parking space, and somebody actually, somebody picked that thumb drive and then he inserted in his laptop, which is government issued, or the organization's, it was issued
and
by the organization.
And they got infected by...
And they got infected, and it was just the entire system went down because of that. So there are many ways on how to, you know, hack into the system of an organization. And one of the most vulnerable, the risk factors, would be the human being.
Yeah. Because that leads me to my second question. I mean, obviously, in our IT setting, we allow employees to bring their own devices, right? BYOD, bring your own device. Is that something that the interagency committee now would also include in its, you know, maybe in its planning? For security protocols that would disallow government employees from bringing their own devices, I mean, as a security threat?
Well, from the point of view of security, definitely it should be, you know, all the devices that are connected into the government network has to be secured. You have to, you know, see if it's actually secure, free from any viruses or any, you know, stuff that that can be inside the USB or any device.
So every device has to be checked? And screened.
It should be screened, because you remember that when you go into the government network and it becomes, you know, compromised or infected, just imagine how many, you know, government networks are actually connected into one.
Yeah. So your IT, at least all the IT offices for each of the government agencies should have a way of screening the devices that employees use for their work.
Yes.
Yeah. Is there something that the interagency committee now is thinking of, Pana? How do you set the guidelines for these employees?
That's the first thing. That's the first order of the day. Mm-hmm. Once we convene, or the committee convenes, we will be setting up the guidelines for that, on how to set first, how to set up the National Cybersecurity Coordination Center, and then creating the National Computer Emergency Response Team, because they will be the ones who will be the NCERT. We call it the NCERT. They will be the ones who's they have the auditing functions and oversight on, you know, the certs, as well as, you know, everything that is related to cybersecurity.
Okay.
And then the National Cybersecurity Coordination Center will work as the secretariat and will be the operating and administrative arm of CIAC.
So you've got a lot of administrative steps to take first.
Yes.
Yeah, more organizational housekeeping.
Yes,
yeah.
That's right. Mm. Otherwise, you know, if we don't put everything in place, we need to come up with also with a policy for that as well. We have to have the information security policy, the national one, and then also the cybersecurity policy as well.
Yeah. You know, I remember the time when the government under the Arroyo administration was trying to put up a broadband backbone, the National Broadband Network, the NBN, and somehow, of course, that got derailed because of some corruption issues. But how important is it for the Philippines itself to have its own broadband network? And that's being done now, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Just imagine if you're going to be sending an email, like agency to agency, and then you will be sending an email. The email would actually pass through, it goes outside the country and then probably hop several countries. So it goes around like 80 hops from different countries, for example, before it goes back to you. But if you have your own government broadband system, then it's, you know, faster and quicker.
And safer.
And safer as well, yeah.
And what is this? What is being done now to actually put that in place, or is it in place already?
They're already starting. They have already set up the fiber optics in several of the government agencies. This is actually handled under the iGov Philippines project, and there are several parallel activities happening right now.
Yeah.
There are several government agencies already are connected through that. Yeah,
and that's basically more secure, you know, than relying on maybe just a telco service.
Yes.
When we talk about security threats, obviously it's not just internal because there are other maybe hostile entities that are interested in finding information. How do we protect ourselves from that?
We are fond of free downloads.
You cannot emphasize that too much.
Yes. So, you know, if we are so fond of free downloads, there are, you know, some instances or chances of opportunities for them to inject something that would penetrate our system. That's one. If we don't like to actually,
would that happen in a government office? People downloading stuff for free?
Not that I know of.
And I'm sure that should be bad, right? I mean, that should be curtailed.
And then if you use pirated software,
okay.
Yeah. And then also at the same time, if you don't, you know, patch your software or your operating system or update your virus, antivirus, well, you know, you're vulnerable to it. You're open to a lot of risks.
Obviously, cybersecurity has a lot to do with encryption and algorithms and stuff like that. We develop our own encryption for our firewalls and all the security, cybersecurity that's put up, right?
We now have the authentication, signature authentication project, PKI.
Okay.
Again, this is under the iGov project, iGov Philippines
PKI
project.
PKI means, again?
Public key infrastructure.
Okay.
So where, you know, it authenticates the person sending the message or the information from one end to another.
And PKI is a system that's used worldwide?
Yes, it is, actually. So that's part of the security measures. So there is, you know, the documents and the communication between the government is secured and protected.
What would be the more critical areas to be protected? What should be the more critical? Department of Finance, as you said, is also included. So our banking systems, of course.
Yeah. Banking system. The banking system, when it comes to their cybersecurity, is more mature now. Because, you know, because they have to protect a lot of, you know, the people's money, there's, you know, the customer's investment. So
there are more online transactions now.
A lot more, yeah. I myself do a lot of online transaction because it's easier, it's more efficient for me because I always go out.
Yeah.
So, the banking is also very, very important. And you also have the telecommunications, the grid, you know, the cell sites, they're very important also.
And they're also vulnerable
to
cyber attack.
Yes, they are.
Is there a preferred, you know, operating system for the government by way of, you know, choosing what platform would be more secure, say, for the government? I mean, do we actually say, oh, Linux is okay, or we say Microsoft's okay, or iOS is okay? Is there a specific choice that has to be made?
I'm an advocate of open source.
Open source.
Yes. So it's the, you know, I've been running around, you know, IT geeks, professionals, you know, and I've seen actually, you know, it works.
Open source works, but how secure is it?
Well, it basically, you know, depends on how, what kind of security protocols you're going to put, you know, include into your open source. But on the same token, there are other operating system or platform. They all have their own security features that are, you know, in place, because definitely they need to make sure that they are secured.
Sure.
Otherwise, they will not get any more clients and they won't be trusted at all. Yeah.
In the U.S., there's such a big hullabaloo about Hillary Clinton having used her personal email to actually conduct official business of the U.S. State Department. Is there such a thing? You know, are we so sensitive about that, government employees or officials using personal email, or do we all use personal email?
Well, in my in my case, you know, I use the email that was issued to me by ICTO,
which is a .gov.ph address.
Yes, that is for just to make sure that it's secured.
Okay.
And if I'm actually sending out, you know, sensitive information, I use the official email address. But with my personal thing, I don't actually, you know, upload or attach any sensitive information.
Sure.
I prefer to call, because my middle initial is actually, you know, P as in paranoid.
Well, Celita Evans, thank you very much for coming over to Future Perfect and sharing with us, of course, some insights into how the NCIAC can conduct its business, of course, with the other agencies that will be set up, the attached arms to the NCIAC.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Happy Halloween.